welcome to another episode of Head Above Water. Today, I'm very excited to speak to actor-producer Tanna Frederick from the movie Two Ways Home. It's about mental health. I'm very excited to talk with her because she's the first filmmaker that I've spoken to that's made a movie about mental health. So we'll talk a little bit about our mental health as filmmakers in this business and the film as well. So Tanna, welcome to the show. It is a pleasure to have you here. Thank you so much for joining us on a Friday the 13th morning.
I love it. I'm so happy to be on the show. Friday the 13th is always a good luck day for me. I don't know why. So I'm honored. This is good.
I didn't even realize it until last night either. My wife was like, you know, tomorrow's Friday the 13th, right? And I'm like, why are you jinxing me? So Tanna, tell me a little bit about yourself. Tell our listeners a little bit about yourself and your career and a little bit about the movie. And then I have so many questions about the movie because, like I said, it's about the topic of mental health and we don't really talk about that a lot, unfortunately.
Absolutely. Well, first of all, I want to say thank you so much for having me on the show. I love the title, Head Above Water.
Thank you. Thank you.
Absolutely. And I think there can't be enough shows about the struggles that we go through as artists and as brains walking around on this planet, you know, and all of those struggles eventually lead to our paths of success. So,
sure. Absolutely.
I really appreciate you voicing and hosting keeping on, keeping on with encouraging everybody to do that. So thank you so much for having me on the show.
My pleasure. My pleasure to have you. So tell me a little bit about the movie itself. Tell me about like the inception of the project, how it came to you, your involvement in it, and what drew you to the subject matter of mental health?
Yeah, well, okay. So I moved out to Los Angeles in 99, which I think I read is the same year that you did,
same,
right?
Exact. Yep. October 9th, 1999. It's funny too, when I tell people October 9th, they're like, why October 9th? I was supposed to come out on October 1st and I got scared. Like I was moving all by myself across the country and I got scared. So I just had to delay my trip for 9 days just to get my head straight. So yeah. And I've been out here for 21 years ever since.
Right. It's a huge move.
It's a huge step.
And I moved out 2 months earlier, which I think it was my 21st birthday. And actually I moved out 3 days before from Iowa. I drove across the country with my Honda Civic and I was nervous as crap, but I had this job lined up, right, with this so-called producer of a company called Make It Happen Productions. And he was like, come on set. I know it's your birthday, but if you're willing to work, I'm shooting a commercial and it'll be a great experience for you. So everybody's excited. My friends are like, oh my gosh, you've already, you know, from Iowa, are like, you've already hooked yourself up with the commercial. This is amazing. It's on your birthday. This is exciting. And I'm like, oh yeah, man, I'm just going with the flow. I'm getting the good energy going.
Yep.
So I get to set and they're like, are you one of the talent? And I'm like, no, I'm not. I'm just here to help. So they gave me a poster board and I ended up wafting smoke all day on set for a 1-900 phone sex commercial.
We all have to wear many hats in this business.
Oh, yeah. I mean, right? Like, it's just hit the ground running, you know?
And we're going to put you right to work. I mean, that's great. I mean, so many people move out here without anything. I had only come out here because I had an internship. I don't know if I would have been able to do it if I didn't have anything lined up. I mean, to have no safety net is... it's a risk. It's quite a risk to take.
It's such a risk and such a journey. Yeah. So speaking of like mental health, it was definitely terrifying. I appreciate your 8-day delay on moving out October 9th. But anyway, so I moved out and after I'd done well and made films, I mean, I'm proud of where I'm at. And then when I was in Iowa, my parents both worked with the mentally ill of North Iowa. And my father being a pharmacist, devised a system of med sets in which he could help the severely mentally ill of North Iowa to stay on their med sets. It was associated with this program, this called the Transition Center, where it helped to get people back on their feet who had more severe cases of mental health issues and get them integrated back into society with a living space. You know, it's a beautiful care facility program.
That's outstanding.
It is outstanding. Yeah. And my mother was a nursing professor for over 35 years at a community college in which she taught nurses to go into the psych unit and deal with people in the psych unit. So being a filmmaker or wanting to be a filmmaker, my mom always sent me these National Alliance on Mental Illness health alerts about or more movie pans, I think. They were more movie pans of like, here's a new movie that just came out that inappropriately or over portrays mental health issues in such a way that adds to the stigmatization of people with mental health problems and so on and so forth. So my mom is always like, you know, can you make a mental health film which gets on the NAMI list of good movies to watch? So that's always been a goal of mine.
I'm sure that list of pans was probably really long.
It was so long, right?
Yeah.
So here I am on your show with a film that is being released finally after a decade of work and has been endorsed by NAMI. So there's my, you know, yeah.
I had seen that on the press release, and that's actually the thing that kind of jumped out at me initially, you know, when I was learning about the film and learning about you. I was like, wow, they're actually reaching out to organizations that are, you know, like you said, trying to fight the stigma of mental health and mental illness. And again, like you said, I mean, there's just so many movies that inaccurately portray it. So when I saw that you were actually working with a professional organization that fights for that kind of stuff, it really piqued my interest because, yeah, we just don't see it very often.
Right. Thank you so much. I think it's always a delicate balance when you make a film about something, you know, a sort of film where you want it to resonate, to not make it too much of a cozy movie, especially with a narrative, not make it too much of a cozy movie and rather sort of intertwine the struggles of the character in the story. It's been a real delicate balance. And I'm really thankful for the cast and the crew and the director, Ron Vignoni, of where it landed up, because it's a beautiful portrayal of, I think, hope of a woman with bipolar disorder.
Yeah, that sounds just super interesting to me. So let me ask you this question then. You said it took about 10 years from start to finish, you know, from inception to getting it out there. And like we just said, it's so rare to see an accurate portrayal of mental illness on screen. What were some of the challenges going along the way that kind of popped up? Like, were there any people that you might have shown rough cuts to, or anyone that you wanted to get involved in the movie that was like, no, we need to go more down the road of something that would become movie pan, you know, something that would become a caricature? How did you kind of, during the course of production, fight against, you know, the urges of maybe other people that were trying to take the project down a road that maybe you didn't want it to go down?
Sure. I mean, it was definitely through the help of the director, Ron Vignoni, and my parents. We kept it really, really close. I think that close creative anchor where there just wasn't room for, you know, too much feedback, too many cooks, you know, can spoil.
Absolutely. Yeah, that's kind of what I was getting at, you know. And I mean, we're independent filmmakers, so we, you know, we're mavericks. We do our own thing anyway, so it's not like you're getting studio notes that you have to, like, the next thing you know, it turns into a Men in Black movie, right? You know? So like it's a little easier to kind of stick to your guns about, you know, the direction that you want the film to go in when you're, you know, an independent filmmaker. So to be able to fight through all that stuff, saying, you know, to not have so many roadblocks, at least in terms of that, you know, it's a little something to make it easier, you know, if easier is the right word.
Yeah. And, you know, the story of the film is what it should be. And I think is what a film about mental health should be, or a film intending to make people feel alone who have a mental health, whether it's postpartum or anxiety, or whether it's, you know, OCD, or whether it's something as simple as like overeating, or a, you know, like a anorexia nervosa, like all of these kind of go back to it being, you know, something that deals with the mind, which is so very prevalent and just not talked about. So I think the beautiful part was the story really was very real. It's about a woman who gets out of jail and wants to go reconcile with her 13-year-old daughter who she's been absent with because of an undiagnosed illness. But it's not about the illness. It's about what this woman does with it, and not even in despite of an adversity with a mental health issue. It's what she has become because of it, or what she becomes because of having bipolar disorder. It's how a mental health issue can actually add to your sort of rainbow of colors and how you paint the world as a survivor, as a leader, you know. And I don't think that there's enough stories about that. So everyone with the story and the way in which Ron Vignoni directed it was just, this is a real story and these are real people. And let's not wink, wink, nudge, nudge about the bipolar issue, because this is what people face. You know, one out of four women mothers do face adversity with mental health issues. And this is how you wear it as a badge of courage. And this story is meant to make people feel less alone.
I'm floored by that. That's the right answer. I'm just saying that's the, and you know, I will say this again, and as a filmmaker myself, those are the kinds of stories that I'm attracted to. Ones that to me aren't, I don't even call them movies. Like, they're just mirrors on the world where you just kind of, I like to put a camera in the corner and let real life play out in front of us and have it just be, you know, it doesn't have to jack up the drama, you know, just for the sake of drama, and just kind of seeing how regular people cope and live their lives and just try to make a go of it just on a day-to-day basis.
Kudos to that. Cause you couldn't have put that more beautifully. Yeah. Just put a mirror in the wall and watch a slice of life.
Yeah. Like, and then, you know, after a while, the actors just kind of fade away and you're just watching people figure out how to, you know, and then that's how, you know, as the audience, you connect to that because, hey, I know someone like that. That's me. You know, people just kind of see the real world reflected right back at them. And it's just the kind of movie I don't think studios make very often. They do sometimes. But again, that's us in the independent space. We can take risks and do that kind of stuff. So I really appreciate hearing that. Let me ask you about your preparation for the role. You kind of answered it a little bit because your parents are involved, and, you know, NAMI is involved. What kind of research, what did you do as an actor to prepare for that role to make sure you were accurately portraying the condition?
Well, again, my mom was just like a DSM manual, walking diagnostic statistic manual. So I made sure that the portrayal was accurate and we were accurate with what would happen going off of meds, because that's kind of, you know, without giving away the movie, but what that sort of situation would be like. So I really checked in so often and also did a lot of research on things that films don't do right, which is to sometimes take a mental health situation and make that the main issue, as if it can never be solved, as if it's something that is impenetrable and somebody has no hope. That's one of the things, you know, to not make it a joke, obviously, because that's also an easy thing to do, is to make it funny, mental health be funny, but not make it a horror film, which there's a lot of like,
sure,
showing portrayals of people with mental health issues as being a murderer or, you know, but sorry, go ahead.
Well, I mean, you know, like you were saying, there's the tendency, especially when we're creating drama. I mean, even though I was saying I like it to be real life, you know, a movie by its very nature still is not real life. So there is always a tendency to try to accentuate. You have to, as a filmmaker, you have to pick and choose the dynamics and pick and choose where your focus is. And there is the tendency to, as you just said, you know, make the issue the focus and make it almost part of the hero's quest or something like that, where, you know, somebody might be ill in the beginning of the movie and their quest is to become healthy at the end.
Right.
But that's just not how real world, you know, the real world works. We don't wake up and then, you know, attack it like I need to make my bed. It's a spectrum and these things never totally go away. We have to learn to live with these things. And that just doesn't always fit into a pretty little box in a film.
Completely.
So that's like the great challenge, to try to find that happy medium between making a compelling drama where shit needs to happen for the, you know, the structure of the film, but not over dramatize and make it into a caricature where it becomes, even if you're not trying to be funny, it becomes almost a joke in a way, because it's so exaggerated that the viewers just gets, like you were saying earlier with the pans, like the viewers, the audiences just get a complete misperception of what just a regular person struggling with bipolar disorder has to go through on a daily basis. And that just feeds into this misperception that we're finally getting down to it now and trying to take care of it, but it's persevered for so long.
Absolutely. And it's a tough thing. If you are making an actual earnest and honest film about mental health, like you said, there's a spectrum of like what you go through. You don't wake up and attack it. I mean, this character is on a journey to reconcile with her daughter, and then she ends up taking care of her grandfather, who has, played by Tom Bauer, who has PTSD. But her struggle and most people's struggles with mental health is to be accepted, is to wake up and make the bed, is to like make breakfast. And those are the unglamorous parts of a mental health affliction or facing mental health issues that get overlooked in film. Those are the parts that people don't want to put money into a movie with, because it's about making eggs in the morning. It's about going to bed at night and saying, I just finished 24 hours of the day and I'm going to wake up again tomorrow and do that, you know? And this character is looking to just try to create a home and trying to create a family and trying to be accepted and just taking it, you know, one step at a time. And so that's not the most exciting portrayal of, I think, what society sort of deems as a picture of struggling with mental health, which is the cool thing about the movie, is that it's real.
It's the mundane things sometimes that we focus on to get through the day. But it's not always, you know, glamorous to put on the big screen. So that's the challenge.
Exactly. And, you know, it's what's really cool about when this film finally, I think we were very lucky with when the film, with the film being completed last year, because when we started shooting and when the story was being made, first of all, mental health never is a popular topic because it's just not always the most fun to face because of stigmas associated with it, when, you know, it could and it should be celebrated as much as it possibly can be as being something that adds to people's lives. There's been so many brilliant scientists and leaders who have bipolar disorder, and not just bipolar disorder, musicians, artists, like so many people who wouldn't be the same person that they grew to be without facing, you know, getting through that. However, when we started shooting, you know, it was, I think, where the world was in 2014, I think we, even to be hopeful, have come a long way in 6 years to where people, even now, like even between last year when we started playing on the film festival circuit, which I'm really grateful to say we've done well, winning awards, not over certain things, but I think people are more willing now. We were in an awareness festival and there were things on the table like child trafficking, such important issues like environmental issues. Yet it's kind of a cool thing to see that this awareness festival chose us as a winner because of the, not as a winner of the festival, but we did bring to light mental health issues, which people are so reluctant to want to talk about. It's just not fun all the time. But I think it coming out now, the world is more open to really looking at the trials and tribulations of facing mental health issues. And especially with the pandemic right now, it'll be interesting to see what happens.
Yeah, I find my movie, it was a 10-year journey to getting it done. And I also feel like it came out at just the right time. It's funny to me, you know, since that was my first feature, to see just the process, the length of the process from inception to release, and when you're, you know, where you're at in life, where the project is at, when it's out to the world is totally different, you know, at least for me, than where I was at the beginning. So I can't help but think that there's just some positive vibes in the universe that say that even though you were on this long journey, there's a reason why you didn't finish earlier. There's a reason why you didn't finish later. You finished the movie at this particular time to capture a particular moment. And I don't know who's pulling the strings on stuff like that. And it's, you know, a question we can't always answer. But I've always had this belief that that kind of stuff just kind of falls into place sometimes.
That is fascinating, right? It is so interesting.
Just that huge process that if I had been, you know, I say it on my show a lot, and you know what, I'm going to toot a horn. My movie was at South by Southwest in 2018. Woo-hoo. But if I had finished it a year earlier, I probably wouldn't have gotten into South by 2017. If I finished it a year later, wouldn't have gotten into 2019.
Right.
So like everything in the world was, you know, conspiring to make that happen. And it sounds like that, you know, is kind of working for your film as well. If you had finished it without any roadblocks and you started in 2014 and you finished in 2016, totally different story. If you took a couple of years longer and you finished it in 2022, who knows what the world's going to look like in 2022? Of course, the pandemic's thrown it all into a, you know, a tizzy.
Right.
So, you know, there's something to be said for finishing it at that moment in time.
That is so true, because we had finished up a year-long tour. We actually still had, I think, about a dozen film festivals left to go to, which we were up, you know, it was a small independent film. It's just like, hit that festival, get it out in each state, because you don't have a huge churning studio system PR team rolling for you. So it's just like, go to each festival, hit it up, and then
do it yourself.
Do it yourself. Build a sort of like local cheer squad in each state by going to festivals. But the pandemic hit in March. And so the silver lining, I think, to that was that everything was canceled, of course, but that we were able to get distribution. And I'm just so grateful that this movie is getting distributed not only at Christmas, when I think that so many people are at home with not just their children. It's a multi-generational story, you know? So it's like people are at home with their, maybe their grandparents, maybe their parents, maybe they're definitely with their kids, and just pulling their hair out, and also just questioning their relationships to their family and their relationships to themselves. But this movie is coming out at a time when people have been in isolation, just seeing their families. And this is just a like reminder of, be strong. Your mental health is important. And what can you share? How can you take care of these generations around you to sort of care for their mental health and their stories as well? So it can't be more perfectly timed with this, honestly.
Yeah. I mean, even just like, we don't want to be in a pandemic, but just even in the last few months since March, the attention paid to mental health, because we're all locked together, it just seems to be coming out at just the right time.
Absolutely.
Let me ask you a little bit about your own mental health process with making the film. So you had said that you had started shooting in 2014.
Yeah.
So you started shooting in 2014. You were on the festival circuit last year in 2019. Talk to me a little bit about your own mental health during the process of the movie. You know, obviously many roadblocks always come up. You even said earlier a little bit about how hard it was to get money to make the picture. Talk to me a little bit about some of how you dealt, you know, you and your team dealt with the roadblocks of trying to get funding, you know, finish the movie, get it out to the festivals, the stress that independent filmmakers feel just when they're sending out 20 film festival applications and you're sitting there, you know, waiting, you know, biting your fingernails, you know, waiting to hear from festivals. And you're just like, you're almost putting in other people's hands, you know, your career success of something that you've put your heart into for so many years. Talk to me a little bit about how you endured, how you persevered during a time that I'm sure multiple roadblocks were being put up to say, we're not going to let you get your movie out there. And you had to just push through that. Talk to me a little bit about that.
Well, I think it's important in the filmmaking process to have one person that you're working with in a sort of, Napoleon Hill called it a mastermind alliance, and mine is Ron Vignoni, the director, because you know what the process is. You submit to 30 to 50 festivals on Without a Box, and it's like crickets, 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 and all of a sudden it's like, does my film suck? Am I not seeing something? You know, and you just have to go to that other person and say, is this crap? Am I nuts? You know, is our film suck?
See, and that's the thing.
I don't care who you are.
The way our industry works is there's all these forces at work to try to tamp you down. And it's not, I don't think it's intentional. No, you know, no film festival wants to like kick an indie filmmaker while they're down.
No, absolutely not.
But there are choices that have to be made. And it's still when you check your email and you open it up and it's, you know, Sundance or whatever saying, thank you for your submission. We were really, you know, we liked your movie, but we got 38 million other movies this year. So thanks, but no thanks. So like, it's very difficult not to take that personally. You know, even though I got, and just, you know, like I got into what I feel is the best film festival in the country, but I didn't get it. It was one of only two film festivals I played the whole year. I sent out, like you said, 30 to 50. I sent out exactly 40. I got into two.
Wow. And see, your attitude is kind of like, we've won over 10 awards at all of these festivals, but we didn't make it into South by Southwest.
Right. So, you know, so we
you know what I mean? It's all matter of like how you're going to look at it, right?
it's all perspective. And us as artists, and at least for me, I'm a very neurotic, anxious person. And I don't call myself particularly pessimistic. But yeah, when even though you could have had the most amazing experience at the most amazing film festival, the moment you get another rejection, you feel worthless. And it's very difficult to try to push through that sometimes when all these forces are, you know, you feel like they're aligning against you sometimes, and it's tough not to take it personal.
And there is that weird ebb and flow of festivals where it's just unexplainable, where you get about 30 rejection letters and then all of a sudden you get that one, hey, you made it. How would you like the world premiere at our festival? And right. then all of a sudden you get 15. You know what I mean? And it just took some person to be like, hold out. Hold on. Like Ron was just like, we're going to get in. Don't worry. Don't worry. And I was like, no, I'm worried. And then, you know, we got in and then 15 followed. And is that not what happens? I mean, I know you said you made it into two festivals, but you probably could have like kept going.
And that's the weird thing about how the whole festival thing is run. And I'm glad we're talking about it too, because especially with the pandemic and just the whole shift of the festival circuit to virtual and online and all that stuff and drive-ins, which are fantastic, things need to change and something needs to shift a little bit. You know, the first acceptance I got was South by Southwest. So I thought my movie was top notch.
Right.
So I was going for higher level film festivals that all said, well, we appreciate that you played there, but no, thank you. And if I hadn't gotten in, I probably would have aimed for a lower level of festivals and maybe gotten into 15 or 20, but I didn't want to play the chasing laurels game.
Right.
You know, I didn't want, you know, to just put, and this is not to rip anyone else because anybody else's project is their own thing and I love them for it. But when I see a poster that the title is like teeny tiny and there's 30 different laurels on it, I'm like, I don't know, you know? So it's a weird dichotomy that I think, you know, like you said, with things shifting now, somebody, I don't know who, there's no like governing body, but like we as a people, as a group of artists need to figure out the best way to move into the future, because I talk to a lot of filmmakers, a lot of directors that get real down about that grind, and to hear how you guys were able to power through it, and your director sounds like an amazing person to just be like, have faith, it's going to happen. And it's sometimes very, very difficult to have that faith when everybody that you as a filmmaker, and I say you like the royal you, you're trying to get accepted by these people and they're telling you no. Like, so it's this weird little dichotomy that I think we all need to kind of figure out a way, you know, in this new age to make it not so important's not the word, but just, you know, we put a lot of weight into these festivals and we put a lot of weight into that to help us with our careers and to take us to the next step. I had a different point of view on it because I've been out here for 20 years. I think you do as well. We've been doing this for a while. So we've kind of been around the block. So we know what the score is. But I talk to young filmmakers all the time that have put their faith into the system to help them continue their careers and build their careers. And it all too often doesn't work out that way. And it just perpetuates the cycle of the tortured artist. I don't think, and I've said this to people on my show before, like, I don't want to be a sad sack, you know, as a filmmaker. I want to be a happy person making happy, positive things for the world. And everything in our business, kind of like I was saying before, conspire to like take that optimism away. And I just wanted, and that's part of the reason why I wanted to start the show, is to try to figure out a way to take that away and give the optimism back to the filmmakers so they don't have to feel like it's such a competition, that there are routes to success that might not have considered going into this as a career, that there are other ways to be successful and you don't need laurels on your poster to be successful. That's just my point of view about it, I guess.
Well, I completely agree with you in that I think you should never, or as little as possible, because we're human, be defined by the successes that you receive. There is a reason. Right. If you're doing what you love to do and you figure out what your purpose is, you know, which I'm getting close to figuring mine out, but it is to create films that help people, that somebody watches it and says, I feel less alone and I like myself a little bit better, you know, personally, you know, as an example, like, because we have been out since 99, you know, and we've seen people come and go and projects
right.
be built up and burned to the ground. And it's like, what is this whole thing for? We've seen reality TV swing in and like crush, you know, mm-hmm. anything good, you know, and we're kind of like, what are we doing? Why are we doing this? Once you figure that out, you really have to be strong and set in why am I doing this art form? What mm-hmm. is it mm-hmm. for, you know? And for me, that is a constant struggle. I mean, look at you with a podcast. You are helping people. You are making people feel less alone by having people on the show every single, you know, you're doing like tons of interviews and you're encouraging other artists and that's beautiful. And so, yeah, I mean, that is a struggle that I think filmmakers need to keep carving out. Young filmmakers is why am I doing this? And what is going to be my success? What do I see as a success right. for myself?
Tell me a little bit then about your process in figuring out what success means to you. You said you're not quite there yet, but you're getting there. You know, having been out here for so long, I'm sure there were times along the way, me as well, where you thought you were going down a road towards success, and then maybe you didn't want to go down that road, so you pivot, or, you know, like, whatever it is, I want to act, but now I'm going to try to produce, and now I want to do this other thing, and just kind of figure out your way out here. Did you find, throughout the last 20 years or so, that your definition for success has changed as you've grown as a person and that you're not quite there yet, but what makes you feel that you're on the right path to success for you? Not success by anybody else's definition, but do you feel a confidence right now, I suppose is the question, a confidence that you're on the right track towards the success that you want for yourself the most?
I think you'll agree with me here when I say that when you find that sweet spot of I'm so very proud I put blood, sweat, and tears into something. And once you find that sweet spot of like, I feel good of what I've done, and then you finally get people looking at it, then you just know when you complete something, you just know. I mean, I guess a good way to talk about it, or a good metaphor, is in Los Angeles, I've done so many long runs of theater. And so many people have said, why the heck are you doing theater in Los Angeles? You know, it's not New York. What's the point? You're losing money. Da 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 da. You know,
it's exhilarating though. I love theater in Los Angeles. I used to work with Sacred Fools Theater up yes! in Hollywood. I mean, it's amazing. Like theater in LA, like a 99 seat theater. Like I said, it's the same thing about as independent movie. Like I want to put up a camera and just show real life.
Yeah.
And that you get that in LA theater. I mean, kind of like off Broadway in New York, but it's a beautiful thing. You can get really right down to the, you know, the rawness.
I have to say, theater in LA is exciting. It is innovative. You know, it doesn't get the same cred as New York, but it's off Broadway. Some of the shows that I've seen in little garages are like unbelievable conceptually yeah. and the talent, and you know, it's what people are. They're squeezing their wants to act into these theaters in LA. And it's a thriving scene. Well, it, you know, knock on wood, it will return to where it was. But
right.
I feel like that kind of that moment where you know that you've hit success is like when you're in theater and you feel complete and sort of complete synchronicity with the audience, so much so that they are with you and you are with them. And there is sort of this there's no difference between that moment that you're living and that moment that they're living, because they've given their sort of like suspension of disbelief
right.
over to you.
Absolutely.
And then you've just said, okay, and I'm being as human as I possibly can. That's kind of like what I feel success is in the film industry, is when, and it's not as palpable because you're watching the screen, but when you, but now that people right. are kind of, when somebody utilizes your film to have a different outlook on life, for me, that is success. And so this film has been really special. Is it perfect? No. Am I going to make a lot more films? Please God, yes. You know, that's continued to make people feel less alone. But like, this is a nice, sweet spot that I'm sitting in right now.
Would you say you're happy with where you're at right now?
With the
or on a path to happy, like as a person, just in life?
I think
you know, a quick, easy question for you.
I know.
You know, two word answer. Give me one sentence on, are you happy? It's a simple one. Come on. You know, I ask people that on the show. I had started the show, I thought that would kind of be a nice little catchy gimmick. Let's, you know, we'll wrap up every show with like, are you happy? And because I always thought happiness was like, I'll make my movie. It'll be successful. It'll make money. I'll sell it. And then I'll be happy, because that's what I always wanted to do. I wanted to make a movie. And if I make a movie, I'll be happy. And it didn't happen. And the more people I spoke to and asked them, I always thought everybody would kind of have the same definition of happiness or think of it as a destination. And the more people I talk to, the more I realize happiness is such a spectrum, and it's such an ideal that it's not, you know, it's not the tape at the end of the marathon that you run through and it's over. It's something, you know, way deeper and more complex than that. So I know it sounds like a simple question because it's just three words, but do you at least feel like where you're at in life now that the movie is coming out, you know, and we're, you know, have the opportunity to share it with the world, that you're at least, you know, if you're not there yet, you're on a path to happy?
Oh my God. You're like, it seems like a simple question. I just need to write a dissertation of the meaning of life right now and throw it out to me in a Cliff's Note version and neat little bow. Oh my God. I am hopeful of the potential of it. You know, I wouldn't have made this if I wasn't worried about mental health. I have had, and I'm sure a lot of people are going through tough stuff. And since I got back to Iowa, I've had, because I've been here since March, and I've had two really, really close people commit suicide. And one of those being my cousin. It's a beautiful,
I'm sorry to hear that.
Thank you. And I'm sorry for him and his family and his son. And I'm not trying to be like a downer right now, although it is really heavy. And one is a co-star that I was on stage with for a year and close friends. And he just did the same thing. And I feel that, can a movie change somebody's mind about that? No, maybe. I don't know.
Maybe. Right. Hey, hopefully.
Yeah. And I feel that what is coming up in terms of mental health, and mental health is going to be like the last thing that is being looked at right now, because there's anger, there's animosity, there's political insanity, there's a pandemic, there's economics, you know. So if people can watch this and do a little self-care, if people watch this and maybe want to say something nice to their parents or reach out to a friend they haven't talked to in a while, then that is like quantifiable happiness for me.
Sure.
But a lot of those moments, I'm not going to know. Am I a little bit more peaceful because I at least made something that could inspire that, a tiny little, you know, pebble being thrown into an ocean of craziness going on in the world? Yeah. I'm a little bit more peaceful. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. It's the victories in the little things. So since, you know, my movie's been out for a while, I hear, my movie's about drug addiction. My father was a heroin addict who passed away. So you're more than welcome to check it out. It's on Amazon. I get emails from people, Facebook messages from people all the time who just randomly found the movie on Amazon for whatever reason. I guess their algorithm just works. I get emails from people that had no idea how to deal with addiction and recovery in their own family, and the movie gave them hope and the movie gave them perspective. And I never, you know, throughout the time I'm making it, it's about me, it's about my father, my family. So I'm kind of focused on that. And then once it's out there and you start seeing how people react to it, it's the little, even though I just get, like, sometimes I'll just get a one line from a total stranger in Iowa or Utah or anywhere in the UK that's just like, hey, I don't need to add you as a friend, but I just wanted to tell you I saw your movie and it really moved me. And it's those little things right there. You're going to get a message like that one day. Someone's going to reach out to you and you're just going to like be floored by it. And listen, I've had plenty of people tell me I'm a whiny bee too. You know, just get over it and all that. So I've heard, you know, the spectrum of one star to five stars. But when you get those messages from just regular old people that just don't care about the film industry as the thing that we're in, and don't they just want to, like you said, connect to a story. And when they do, and when it comes back at you, even as I'm saying it, like, I'm realizing, like, that's the happiness for me.
Right.
Like, even though we have all these other struggles we have to deal with, and am I happy in life? I'm not happy right now. The world does suck. You know, I don't know what's going to come next. And I hate that feeling. I hate not having control over my life and not knowing what the hell's going on. So it was kind of leading into my next question of how you deal with these times. But for me, when I get just a message like that, and even though my movie's been out for 2 years, they still trickle in every now and again. I'll get a friend request on Facebook from a total stranger and be like, who are you? Why are you friending me? And then I'll go to my messenger and see a message, you know, like, oh, this person just wrote, hey, I saw your movie and I loved it. And it really, and it doesn't, for me, it doesn't last forever. Sometimes like it fades away really quickly when I turn on the news, which I shouldn't be doing anyway, but just in that moment, to hear from someone, to connect to someone, as much as we argue about how bad social media has been the past few years and how it's contributed to the, you know, the strife and the anger in American society today, to just crack open your messenger and see a total stranger put themselves out there by reaching out. Because how many other people have seen the picture that don't reach out?
Absolutely.
You know, which is cool too. But to hear from people like in that moment, that happiness, that's what drives me. That's what sticks in my craw that makes me want to keep going and not give up and know that we are here to contribute something and leave something behind, something positive for the world. And you're going to hear that as well when the movie comes out.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, those are the moments, like you said, that make it worth it. Those are the moments that are absolutely phenomenal, and especially now, you know, especially in these times. Do I think a Will Ferrell movie can't create one of those moments? No, I do.
Sure.
I do think because we need to laugh and we need to outweigh all the mishigas right now with as many moments of connection, whether it's a beautiful connectedness without being lofty, you know. And are all the moments going to be beautiful? No, some of them will be confrontation, some of them will be somebody saying, yeah, that wasn't my cup of tea, which, you know, we're filmmakers. That's our job, is to like make movies.
I've learned some people won't
like
them.
That's totally cool. Least thanks for watching it, you know, thanks for looking at it. Yeah. Thanks for considering that. But yeah, that's beautiful that people are writing that to you.
Yeah. And I have, like I said, I have no doubt that you won't be getting the same messages because, like I said, the trailer looks amazing and it's going to really resonate with a lot of people, I think. So let me ask you one last question before I let you go, because I'm really interested in it. So you're in Iowa right now.
Yes.
What do you do when you're, you know, stressed out or having a bad day or something? Like, what do you do to de-stress? Like you said, self-care, stay positive. In this environment, what can you do to kind of stay upbeat while we ride this thing out?
That's a really good question.
I get hiking a lot. Since you're in Iowa, that's why I'm kind of curious, because when I talk to the LA filmmakers, they're like, I've had multiple people, I go hiking. I was like, great, I live in Long Beach. I'm not driving up to, you know, I'm not driving up to Laurel Canyon. I can't do it.
Right.
Although I did used to hike up there. So
listen, it's flat in Iowa. Like, it's not. Yeah, there's like, no chance of hiking. It's 18 degrees today. You know, there's a Pizza Hut and there's a McDonald's.
Right.
So how am I going to make a happy party? The heck if I know. I think what you said about say what you want about social media, but right now it's just, I feel like I have to put out 20 times the energy that I used to have to.
Right.
To like stay with my head above water. I have to make a Herculean effort to get through 24 hours. And sometimes it's just 24 hours. And you know, I am sober. So I was an addict and am an addict. And for me, it's like, wow, like I used to take these times where I was just sitting around and it'd be like the perfect time to like drink and like watch movies. And I just don't have that luxury anymore. So I'm like, what is happy? What does happiness mean? What does contentment mean? What the hell is going on right I know.
I have not, you know, I don't particularly call myself an addict because I've never been like diagnosed or anything. Obviously, like I said, my father's an addict. I've had trouble with food my entire life. So, you know, even though like I don't call myself an addict because I've, you know, I am, but like no one's ever said, hey man, you're an addict. So like I don't use the term for me, although it probably does apply. But I know that struggle, especially right now since March, of just getting through the 24 hours.
Yeah.
Sometimes there's just nothing to do and I try to write and I sometimes can't write and I'm stupid. Like I said, I watch the news too much and I read Twitter. And Twitter is the, like we were saying about the social media, it's awful because of what it can be. But boy, the people I've met, the people I've connected with, the people I hear from about the movie and filmmakers and old friends from high school. It's why I still love Facebook, even though I don't talk to them. I love seeing my high school friends' lives. You know, I love.
Oh yeah, I mean, I'm checking in with like cousins that I haven't checked in with for like 5 years because I'm so damn bored and like trying not to like think about drinking.
Right.
And I'm just like tick tick tick. What do I do? I'm gonna write Aunt Flo. I haven't heard from.
I have an Aunt Flo.
I love Aunt Flo. Yeah.
And, you know, so it just it becomes hard to just fill in the day with stuff. And the one thing that I've kind of learned or taught myself or come to accept is that it's okay not to be productive every day. You know, sometimes I'll, and I don't mean like I can't get out of bed not productive. I'll, like I said, I'll get up, I'll come into the office and I'll try to do some writing or something. And like I said, there's no, the way things are right now, there's no deadlines to me. So like I have real hard time fighting through procrastination. If I don't write somebody now, I'll just do it tomorrow. No big deal. And it just kind of can snowball. So I've kind of learned to not be so hard on myself if I don't do everything.
Good.
And, you know, and be kind to myself and not beat myself up if I don't, you know, do something great today. Because greatness may come tomorrow.
That is the best thing I think that you could have said to me or to anybody listening right now. Because forgiveness and acceptance of yourself right now is so crucial mm-hmm. because it is, because there is no point. There's no, there, it's hard to get external points of reference.
Right. Because that's exactly
everybody
right.
else is frying mm-hmm. in their houses.
Right.
Thinking that they're not getting shit done.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if I can swear on the show, but like,
yes, you absolutely fucking
you
can.
Edit that out. But seriously, like,
I'm from New York City. I'm surprised I haven't cursed more than this.
Yeah. So everybody's like, what? That's what I would like to posit that everybody is going through. I would like to posit the hypothesis that everybody's just frying. And plus I talk to people who are frying and moms who are frying. And I'm like, is it taking anybody else like 5 days to get one to-do list item done?
Right? My number one item is make a list, and I haven't even done that yet. You know, I was like, I gotta make a list of things to do,
and it's like, well, fine, okay, so I didn't do it today, so I didn't even make the damn list, whatever, right?
Yeah, tomorrow is a new day, and it will get done, and we will persevere, and just know, like I said, because you were talking about your friends that you've lost, and it's, you know, it's been a topic lately, and it's real easy to think that there's nothing coming next.
Right.
Because we don't know what's going to happen.
We don't know.
And it's the first time in my life that I just didn't know what the next day will bring. So it's easy to put the weight of the world on one's own shoulders and take all of that pressure and try to make something happen when, you know, everything else is saying stop.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's just, again, it's all about, you know, self-care and being kind to yourself and staying within your limitations in that, knowing what you're capable of and knowing that that is achievable. Like, it's not, if you don't get something done on one particular day, it doesn't mean you're a loser. It just means that day might have sucked, but tomorrow will be anew. It will be. And I'm trying to, you know, for myself and for the show and for the listeners and for everyone, to try to let people know that this will end. And everyone's like, when are we going to go back to normal? We're not going back to the world that was in February. We're just not. But we can learn how to operate, you know, even after everything opens back up and we have a vaccine and everything is, and that's behind us. The world's going to be a very different place. And we need to start giving ourselves the tools to operate in that new space and figure it out. And I don't think anyone has the answers right now.
And we need to give ourselves the credit.
Yes.
We've gone through a freaking pandemic in the last 7 months. We need to give ourselves the credit that if you are still on this earth right now, if you are sitting at home, like, I don't care if you're day drinking. I don't care if you're getting stuck. I mean, I
right,
do,
right.
you know,
but if that's but your like, thing,
it's
that's
okay.
Your thing.
Be cool right. to yourself because you deserve right. it. And you already are a soldier of adversity, having gone through that. The anger that is rising up around when you are not giving yourself bear hugs.
Right. Right.
Then you're getting mad at yourself, and it's really easy to do right
yes.
now. And then that's going to go out and bleed into like everybody in the community. And it sounds like such hippie logic, but I'm in Iowa and it's a red
right.
state. So,
so you have an even harder battle. Before I let you go, so tell me a little bit more about the movie. Tell me when it's going to be out, where it'll be available. Let's have everybody, you know, get ready to add it to their queue and check it out. Tell me a little bit more about Two Ways Home and where we'll be able to find it and all of that fun stuff.
So the movie is coming out. It is in pre-sales in November 28th, and then it comes out December 29th.
Fantastic. And we'll put links to all of those pre-sales and stuff
on demand.
In the show notes. So we'll give everybody a way to get to watch it. Again, Tanna Frederick, it was an absolute pleasure talking with you today. It was a fantastic conversation. And I wish you nothing but success for the movie, success for yourself, however you define it, and all the happiness that the world can provide. Thank you so much for joining me today. I love talking with you.
Thank you for having me, and you are a godsend to everybody, and it was my pleasure, and I am right there with you, dude. I got your back.
I appreciate that.
I got your back through this.
Team Head Above Water, we're coming right at you. Thanks again, and gang, check out the show. We'll have all this info about our movie in the show notes, and we'll talk to you soon. Thanks a lot. Take care. Bye-bye.